Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you how many more SpaceX Starship prototypes we can expect in the next few weeks and when a possible test date for the 15-kilometer Starship flight could be.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Looks like it's handled.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. Hello Y family, here we are again watching SpaceX and their latest progress in Boca Chica, Texas. Recently I had a conversation with one of the Y community members and the question we tried to answer was, what's the secret of SpaceX's success? When looking at the footage provided for the show by RGV Aerial Photography, the speed and scale of the project becomes apparent quickly. The scope is getting larger and larger, and we haven't seen anything yet if Elon Musk really does turn his idea of 1,000 starships into reality. The speed at which SpaceX will have to build starships to make the goal is unprecedented in the launch industry. So, is this the first Starship Gigafactory we're looking at? For such a manufacturing speed, SpaceX will need the machine that builds the machine. A facility capable of pumping out and assembling starships and super heavy segments on a daily basis. The largest rocket in the world, and SpaceX wants to mass produce it. What you're looking at here is another awesome picture taken by Mary, aka Boca Chica Gal, for NASAspaceflight.com. The picture shows a few very sturdy and heavy parts recently delivered to the construction site at the SpaceX South Texas launch site. They are one of the puzzle pieces needed for a fast production rate. It's the new bridge crane to be installed under the roof of the almost finished high bay. And it's needed too. SpaceX could already be building super heavy boosters. Looking inside the high bay through one of Mauricio's awesome pictures, scaffolding becomes visible. To be precise, two large scaffoldings have been built by the SpaceX workers. Those scaffoldings are new. I don't know exactly yet what they are meant for, but they have something to do with super heavy construction. Looking closer at the pictures, the typical black construction jigs can be seen. So either SpaceX intends to initially build two super heavy boosters right from the start, or the approach might be similar to Starship production and they will build two halves and stack them to create one large booster in the end. Bridge crane and scaffolding on the floor show that SpaceX would love to start constructing boosters right now. And what happens if one department is not as fast as the other one? You have piles building up. In this case, the pile is made of super heavy booster segments. Once SpaceX can finally start using the high bay, the first booster hull should go up in a matter of days. I'm counting one 5-ring segment with internal bracing, two with 4 rings and internal bracing, and 4 4-ring segments without bracing. A super heavy booster should have between 36 and 38 ring segments when fully assembled. What's sitting in front of the high bay right now are segments with a total of 29 rings. If we add the 9 rings needed for the 3 dome segments, we arrive at 38 rings. And considering that both top dome and common dome segments for the first super heavy booster have already been spotted, we could already be looking at an almost complete booster. Only the engine section has not been spotted yet. So in theory, the first super heavy booster could still be flight ready by the end of the year. Which would show once more that SpaceX's approach of development repeatedly produces results which would just not be possible with any conventional approach. Built in segments, each Starship prototype right now is made of a whole set of pre-manufactured parts. It's a bit like Lego right now, a pipeline of prototypes constantly being improved and assembled over and over again. Brandon has kindly supplied me with his latest progress diagram for today's episode. In this overview, SpaceX's fast progress becomes apparent. Brandon shows only assembled and confirmed parts here. Starships serial number 5 and 6 start the line. Both have already flown successful hops and can be seen as early demonstrators of the tank section part of a SpaceX Starship. On we go with Starship serial number 8, which right now is sitting on top of a test stand at the launch site undergoing final assembly and static fire. After stacking the nose cone on top, a few steps are still left before tests can proceed. Fuel and data lines need to be connected. Header tanks need to undergo pressure testing. Another static fire needs to be done. Maybe even more than one, as SpaceX will also want to test the header tanks before a first flight. And after all this is done, serial number 8 will finally take flight to a height of 15 kilometers, which surpasses the typical cruising altitude of an airliner by 5 kilometers. Next we have serial number 9 with an already stacked tank section awaiting flaps installation inside the midbay. After this it would be ready for cryogenic testing. Then we have Starship serial number 10, which only needs stacking of engine section with aft dome and the upper tank section. Then it would already be on par with serial number 9. We also have the engine skirt of serial number 11. Here only the common dome segment connecting oxygen and methane tanks is missing. Serial number 12 is even further along than what we can see on Brendan's diagram. In this picture, taken by Mary from NASA Spaceflight, we can see serial number 12's nose cone skirt. The ring segments directly under the nose cone itself. The always evolving weld quality is very much visible here. Compared to when it all started, the SpaceX welders by now are professionals when it comes to attaching two ring segments. Around 1 month ago, Eric released this render on Twitter. It shows a project we're working on in the background at the moment, which will depict a first commercial Starship launch from start to finish. Replying to this tweet, which shows a perfectly good looking Starship, Musk added that the circumferential welds and skin panels will be much smoother in future builds. So even smoother than this, which basically would mean that the finished Starship design from the outside will look as smooth as every other rocket, and that the typical ring segments visible on every prototype right now will almost vanish and hardly be visible at all. Will SpaceX after all make the ring segments taller or reduce welds? Once exact hull dimensions and configuration are narrowed in on, it would very much make sense. Every weld costs time and money and makes the build process more complex with new opportunities for possible problems. Going back to Brendan's diagram, he finishes the list of available parts with lots and lots of super heavy segments. And again, if all the segments sitting outside the high bay right now are for super heavy, the list is even longer. And what you always have to remember when looking at such a list is that no prototype is the same as the last. Serial number 12, once it's finished, will have many smaller and maybe even bigger differences compared to, for example, Starship serial number 8, currently sitting on the test stand and waiting for future tests. Like the episode so far? Then make sure to subscribe, hit the like button, and consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Your support makes all this possible in the first place. And if you want to show the world that you're a fan of What About It and rockets, check out our merch store and dress differently. It's full of designs made to fill your closets and drawers with awesome shirts, hoodies, zippers, jackets, space caps, cups, bags, you get the idea. Every sale supports the channel, links are in the description. You rock! Speaking of further tests, SpaceX has yet again announced new test dates. If this was a hotel, we could turn the no vacancy sign on. Besides Halloween on October 31st, every day is fully booked right now. There are two new primary test dates on November 1st and on November 2nd. November 1st would yet again be a night test date, maybe for a static fire, and on November 2nd we have another whole day set as a test. Could it be that on November 1st we get the final static fire and that on November 2nd SpaceX is planning the flight? That would be Monday with backups on Tuesday and Wednesday. If anyone from the Boca Chica workforce is watching this, our thoughts are with you and many fingers are crossed. Go for it. We can't wait to see your prototype fly. You rock. As most of the time at this point, switching over to the launch site, a few interesting developments have been documented as well. Mary took a picture of the new manufacturing tent at the orbital launch mount site. It's interesting for a few reasons. First of all, it rules out the tent as a possible place for a Starship presentation, in my opinion. I am pretty sure Musk won't do the presentation in front of a large trailer office. Secondly, it shows that the tent and the trailer might be here to stay for at least a bit longer. Looking at the same site from above on one of Mauricio's pictures, it shows the exact shape of the foundation. On October 23rd, when the picture was taken, the trailer was not there yet, but the foundation already was, of course, and it very much looks like the foundation was planned for this. I mean, of course it was, but it shows once more that this might not be so temporary. It would be really interesting to know how much force from three Raptor engines actually reaches the tent. With a fully equipped booster, 28 Raptor engines would most likely at least damage the tent, if not completely blow it away. But would three Raptors do the same? It certainly is uncomfortably close. The effect of engine exhaust should not be underestimated, and SpaceX obviously knows this. At the test stand area, for example, the dirt rampart initially built by SpaceX to protect the fuel farm from anything bad that could happen on the test stands next to it has been extended to now include the second stand. Dirt walls are a non-permanent structure, and so SpaceX can modify it as they see fit. But something like this right now seems to not be planned at the orbital launch mount. Next to all of that, the launch control center seems to be largely done from the outside by now. Last but certainly not least, the number of parts at the orbital launch site has reached an all-time high. They are everywhere, with narrow roads navigating between the piles. We can find all sorts of things here. Long metal supports, countless boxes and pallets filled with small metal parts, and some more distinctive parts. For example, these red parts here look very interesting. They look like large hydraulic cylinders with some sort of spoon-shaped metal parts attached. Three different sizes can be found, from rather small to large. What are these for? Have you seen something like this before? Tell me in the comments what you think. I'm always eager to read your thoughts. So SpaceX is progressing at the usual speed. We're all still waiting for the highly anticipated Starship Serial No. 8 flight, and we might have a possible date on November 2nd, if the static fire happens during the night test window on November 1st. The next 2 months hold a few very exciting moments in store for us. Engineering work at its finest. Hundreds of workers all united behind one large idea, each one doing their part to turn the idea into reality. It's amazing to see, and that's the essence of a well-developed plan. If you find this as interesting as I do, maybe a job in the STEM field is the right choice for you, and today's sponsor is the perfect place to start learning about it. One of Brilliant's top courses is about chemistry. Here you can learn all about the substances of which matter is composed. The investigation of their properties and reactions, and the use of such reactions to form new substances, can be incredibly interesting. The Sabatier process is just one of many processes that might shape our future. This is just one example of all the courses on Brilliant. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. All of Brilliant's courses have storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problems to solve. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Learn new things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. Today's YouTube member and patron shoutout goes to Pete Obermanns, Steve Singer, and many others. You rock! The family is growing, and the team and I thank you so much for your support. If you want to be part of the Discord community, chat with me and others on the voice channels, or even be part of the team that helps create What About It twice a week, consider becoming a patron or a YouTube member by clicking on the link in the description or the join button right under this video. Thank you. And here's my thank you to the most awesome bunch of people I could have possibly hoped for. Just 2 days ago, I recorded a podcast with a few of them about how YouTube changed my life. I'll share a link to it as soon as it's out. It wasn't just YouTube, though, that changed my life. It also was the team, constantly motivating me, helping with ideas and feedback, and making each episode a bit better than the last one. Thank you for being a part of this. You rock. SpaceX could already be building Super Heavy Booster.
Super Heavy Booster? Super Heavy Booster! Yay!
Which surpasses the typical cruising altitude of an airliner.
An airliner. It's the good old airliner.
Every prototype right now will almost finish and vanish. We can find all thwarts.
Thwarts.
Lots of thwarts. Exikixning extlapakstapak.